Good morning. Welcome to Kingdom Living Church. We're just going to pray and then from there we go into our praise and worship. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Father, for such a beautiful day today is. Thank you, Lord, that you made it possible for us, Lord, to see this day which you have created. Thank you, Father, for your protection over us all through the night, Lord. In our sleep, in our dreams, Father, you are there. You protected us. We say hallelujah to your name. We say glory be unto your mighty name. As we come together this morning, Lord, we come in your name, in the name of Jesus. And we are praying, Father, that you take control of everything we're going to do within the hour, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, we welcome your presence this morning. We welcome your presence even in the home of those and in the life of those that are tuning in through the Facebook right now in the name of Jesus. We say, Holy Spirit, touch every heart today in the name of Jesus. We want to see you move mightily this morning, Lord, even in our sermon in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray that your children will come, Lord. We come with a heart of gratitude to praise and worship you this morning. And Lord, take all the glory, take all the honor, take all the adoration, because they are all for you, Lord. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I've prayed. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
So we're just going to go into our praise and worship. And I just want to encourage us, really. Welcome to those that are just tuning in on Facebook and then even when you're going to tune in on YouTube as well. But I want us to come with a heart of gratitude this morning to just praise the Almighty God, because He is an awesome God and He's done marvelous things in our lives. So this is the moment to just hand it over to Him through praise and worship. Praise God.
You are the Holy One. You
excited this morning to be in your presence and to magnify your name and glorify your name, because your everlasting love never changes, never fails. There is nothing we can do to earn your love. Your love was freely given in Christ Jesus. Our responsibility is just to accept it. Lord, we want to thank you for your love for us. I want to thank you for the way you have preserved our lives over this time. I want to thank you for the way you are answering our prayers concerning our nation as we cry now for this coronavirus infection rate to fall and the death rate to drop down. We thank you that that's beginning to happen, so we give you praise, Lord. I want to thank you for members of our families and our friends and our colleagues, our neighbors and people that we know. We want to thank you for Christians all over the world who are worshiping now. I want to thank you for many of those who are at home who don't even know you. But Father, we lift them up to you and say thank you for preserving their lives. Because the Bible says your rain falls on the righteous and the unrighteous. Because you are a good God. Thank you for your goodness. We lift you up in your homes. I just want you to start to give God thanks. On Facebook, start to send a text message to say thank you, Lord. Exalt his name. If you want to speak your own language to give God thanks, please feel free to do that. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Our God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Okay, I think we'll just quickly go through our notices. And then we also go take our offering. And then we sing and then we go to our seven. So welcome to Kingdom Living Church Saints. It's a amazing Pentecostal church movement, and we are really delighted to have you with us this morning. On the screen there you will find our notices for Mondays. I think men's meeting starts again on this Monday, and of course Tuesday women's prayer meeting. Then Wednesday we have our Bible study. So whatever I teach here today, we're going to dissect it on Wednesday and take some questions. And then on Friday, we have our prayer meeting at 7:30. All this on Zoom at 7:30. 7:30 on Monday, Tuesday, and 7:30 on Wednesday and Friday. But there's something we are doing in our church this month, for the whole month of lockdown. We are having a 5 a.m. prayer group for 20 minutes. And we want to say thank you for all those who will be joining. And I send Bible reading notes and prayer points out every day. And we pray for our nation. And we are praying for people's dreams to come through. We are praying for you, for your children, your husband, your wife, your siblings, your parents, your neighbors, your colleagues. So we are touching every life, praying for this nation, that dreams will be awakened, that people will rise up with dreams. Because men and women and children of dreams, they are the one that builds the nation. And so we are praying for people's dreams to be realized and to come to pass in Jesus' name. I just want to use this time to pray for people who, in your home, your children are struggling. We are talking about dreams, and they are not really following the Lord. Not only that, but they are being lost. Some of them seem to have lost their way and don't know what to do. So I just want to pray for you. Father, I pray for this family that is struggling to bring their children under control. Or for this family that sickness and death has destroyed their home. Either the death of a loved one, or somebody has lost their job and is just creating trouble in the family. Lord, I lift them to you. Somebody is sick and not able to go to work. And children are struggling as a result of that. Can't focus on school. Behaviors changing. Lord, I lift this family to your hands. I pray you that the God of comfort, that you bring comfort to these children, that you address their worry and their trouble and their fear. Meet them where they are, where parents have not been able to reach them. Psychologists and social services have not been able to connect with them. Involved with police have not been able to reach them. But you are God who created them. You can reach them where they are. I pray for your grace upon them. I pray that you will reach them and lift them up. The vacuum in their lives, you will fill it, Lord, in Jesus' name. You will address their fear. You will address their worry. You will bring hope in place of hopelessness. I pray that you will meet their financial needs. You will meet their emotional needs. You will meet their spiritual needs. And you will meet their psychological needs. I pray that you bring people across their path to walk with them, to walk with the parents, to walk with the husband and the wives and the children. I just want to give you thanks and praise, Father, for transforming this family with your hope and grace. In Jesus' precious and most holy name we pray. Amen. 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 So let's take our offering. We're not going to dwell too much on our offering today because I know many of you already give online. And so if you are joining us for the first time, the online details, bank details are on the screen for you. We'll give you a few minutes to go. You can give by text message, by text, or you can give by directly transferring money to the church account. I want to thank you for the work that you all are doing in supporting the work that we do here. And the truth is, a lot of the money that we get here, just not able to pay for the salary and other things we do. We also use it to support people in the neighborhood. We provide food to people in our neighborhood, to some of the homeless around us. And we reach out to these people. It is your giving that enables us to do that. And so we want to encourage you to continue to support us. And some of the work we do here, we work with churches abroad. Like I can tell you, for the past 3 years, I've been traveling to Nigeria to work with about 60 churches, 60 pastors that we work with in partnership with other people. So our goal is to reach out to the nations and the community around us. So please continue to support us. Father, we commit this giving into your hands as people give to you. We pray, Lord, you that is the God that supplies all our needs, that you will meet their every need. Apostle Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He's also talking about you are the one who meets our needs. And Father, Lord, I thank you. David Samuel said, I lack nothing. We lack nothing in you. You meet all our needs. Father, I want to thank you even for those now who are not sure of where the next meal is coming from tomorrow. We pray, Lord, that you bring somebody across their path to bring blessings to them. That you make us instruments of blessings to these people. Meet the need of your people today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I also want to pray for somebody, people who are looking for jobs. I really sense God said to pray for you today. You are looking for a job, you've been given, and you are saying, Lord, I want to give more, but you're looking for a job. Or you're thinking of starting a business, and I want to pray for you. If you are here too, I also want you to connect with it and receive it in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray now for those who are looking for a job, even in this time. The economic situation is challenging and many people have lost their job, but the economy of heaven hasn't changed. You are still able to provide jobs for those who need it or want to work. So I lift them to you, and even those who want to change their job to a better one. I pray that you will connect them for the right job by your divine connection. You bring them into network with those who have a job. You connect them with not just any job to pay the bills, but the right job for them, where they will rejoice and celebrate and fulfill their purpose. Thank you, Lord, for setting them in the path of progress through this job to be a place where they can also share your love and your grace. In Jesus' name. So receive the job, receive it on your behalf, and pray and thank God that it is done. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hope have you forgotten anything? No. Okay. We just pass it on to Deborah and Patricia, of course, to lead us in the next song.
Thank you.
heart to hear the word. We pray that your word will come like a shining light, that will enlighten our hearts and our minds and our spirits, Lord. That you will sow your truth inside our in our spirit. We pray that you come like a flood, like rain to water the grounds of our heart, so that the things that you sow in there will grow to become plant trees that will bear fruit, not just in our lives, but in the life of many others. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you very, 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 very much. Thank you, praise. Praise God. Somebody hearing me, praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Are you ready to hear the word of God?
Yes.
Yep.
Good. Our God is good
all the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
This morning, I want to share with you what I have titled The Heart of a Worshipper. The last few months, we've been dwelling on the heart of worship. And the focus has been on God Himself and on what worship is about. Before, we have focused on the Lord and focused on the throne of heaven and focused on the scenery around God, God's throne. But today we want to look at it, we'll be looking at things from God's eyes, but today we want to look at the things from the eyes of the worshiper. From the eyes of the heart of worship. This is in continuation on what we were also doing last week. It's just tying it all together. We looked at the cost of worship. Now we're looking at the sacrifices we make, what pulls us to a place where we give to God in worship. But today we are going to look at the heart. Why does that happen? What happens in the heart of the one who is worshiping God? What does worship do to the heart? We're going to focus on, as usual, again on Revelation chapter 4, that the Bible says in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1 to 11. Revelation chapter 4, from verse 1 to 11. I want to open up my. Okay, let me have the Bible here, don't I? So, if you can open that up on the screen, please. Revelation 4, 1 to 11. Just give me a minute. Are we all there? I'm not there on my pocket. Just give me a few minutes, one point. Revelation 4, let me change the translation. What translation have you put up there?
Amplified.
Yeah?
Amplified.
Amplified, okay. It says, after this I looked and behold a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I have heard, like the sound of war trumpets, speaking with me, said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after these things." At once I was in special communication with the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven, with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there appeared like a crystalline sparkle of a jasper stone, and the fiery redness of sardius stone. And encircling the throne, there was a rainbow that looked like the color of an emerald. 24 elders' throne, other thrones surrounded the throne, and seated on this throne were 24 elders dressed in white with crowns of gold on their head. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I want to touch on three things here. On my first slide, we are all invited to live a life of worship. You could see that the angel said to him, "Come up here." There was an invitation for John to come up further. Before this time, John has been speaking, God has been speaking to him about, talking to the seven churches. And that's why the Bible says, after all these things, after he has spoken, after Jesus has spoken through him, John was now, the angel said, "Come up here. Come up here." There was an invitation. You see, there is invitation for every one of us to come to a place of worship, to come to a life of worship, to come to a place where we adore God. It's an invitation. Say to somebody, God is inviting you to come to worship. See, this invitation is thrown out to everyone. This invitation is thrown out to everyone, to Christians and non-Christians. Say, come up here. And so a worshiper accepts God's invitation. So the person with a heart of worship accepts that invitation. They turn up for worship. Their life becomes a place where God is worshipped. When God wakes them up, they respond in worship. When they are faced with challenges in life, they will respond with worship. God has invited them, "Come, turn your life over to me. Let your life become a place of worship. Let your heart become a place where I am worshipped. Let your heart become a place where I am exalted, where I am adored." And you see, the scene that was described in heaven was a heavenly scene. So worship is a heavenly thing. It's not just an earthly thing. Many of us, we look at the earth, we let the things of the earth influence our lives. Worship is a heavenly thing. The focus is on God. And so a worshiper connects with heaven. A worshiper accepts the invitation to come into the throne room and make their life a worship to honor God. And then they connect with heaven. The Bible said that we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. He said our life is hid with Christ in God. So we are there when we become Christians. So you now make a conscious decision now to turn to God. And then you find out that in the third one, said, "What?" Then he said, "I was taken in the Spirit." He was already in the place of revelation where God, Jesus, was speaking to him. And now he said, "Come up further." And then as he was coming up further, the Spirit took hold of him. So that tells you worship is a spirit thing. Sometimes we misunderstand this thing. Jesus was saying, I think it's in John chapter, yes, Jesus said in John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. He said, the Father is seeking for those who worship God in his spirit and his truth. God is seeking for those who will worship God in spirit and in truth. God is seeking. He said, but the time is coming and is already here when the true worshiper will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, from the heart and the inner self, talking about the spirit, and in truth, for the Father seeks such people to be his worshiper. God is the Spirit, the source of life, yet invisible to mankind, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Sometimes we make worship about song. When the song doesn't go right, we don't have a good service that day. We make worship about musical instruments. Sometimes we want to talk to God, but we must be worshiping in the background. But if you notice in this scene, I think this scene is the best description of worship in heaven. I don't know of anywhere in the scripture that describes the scene of heaven, the throne of God, like this scene, like this scripture. Yet you don't hear anything about song or musical instruments. Yet he's talking about pure worship. So you see, worship is not just about songs. Songs and music, they are aids to help us worship God. Singing is just an aspect of worship. There are so many angles to worship, but overall, worship is a lifestyle. So God is inviting us not just to come and sing, to make it a lifestyle. See, worship arises in our spirit. It is projected to our soul and amplified in our body. And many of us, we don't understand. We worship God from our soul. We worship God from our mind. So when we get emotional when we worship, and we think that is it, but the truth is, worship is deeper than our emotions. Worship is deeper than our thinking. Worship is deeper than our reasoning. Worship is a spirit thing. It arises in the spirit. That's why Jesus was saying we need to worship God. God is seeking for those who worship from their spirit. Because when you operate from your spirit, God is able to bypass the mind and bring to you an understanding of what he is doing. God speaks to our spirit. So when it comes to a place of worship, worship rises from the spirit. When worship in your spirit comes out, it projects the revelation of who God is to your mind. And your mind starts to accept it and process it. And as your mind catches it, sends a message to the body, and your body starts to express it. So worship doesn't start from outside in, it begins from the inside to come out. So when you are singing, you are projecting what the Spirit of God has sown in your spirit. When you are obeying God, you are obeying in your physical flesh what God has sown in your spirit. So God has touched your heart. You've come to a place, remember we say, worship is a place in heaven. It's a heavenly thing. And you are able to behold the goodness of God. And that causes something within you to rise. For example, when Paul saw the vision of Jesus and he wrote to Damascus, the Bible said, he said, "Lord, what will you have me do?" His spirit caught the lordship of Christ and he responded in worship, "What will you have me do?" And Jesus instructed him on what he was going to suffer for his kingdom. And then Paul, for the rest of his life, lived that life of worship. Because it was so in his spirit. His mind was caught it and he asked, "Lord, what do you want me to do?" And when Jesus said it, Paul started to follow it. He committed his life to it all the days of his life. Point number four, worship is a place of revelation. See, in worship we come to revelation of who God is. In worship we receive revelation of what God wants. You see, when we are talking about worship, we give to God in worship. And we don't just give to God anything. If you look at the story of, I think in Genesis chapter 4, you hear the story of Cain and Abel. The Bible says that Abel offered what he had to God. In Genesis chapter 4. And then Cain also offered the fruit of the ground. He was a farmer. He brought the fruit of the ground and offered it to God. But in Hebrews chapter, don't know if I brought it here. Hebrews chapter 14 verse 4. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 4, sorry. I think it should be on your screen. It said, the Bible tells us in Hebrews, it said, "Faith moved Abel to choose the more acceptable sacrifice after God had sacrificed to offer to God than his brother Cain. And God declared him righteous because his offering of faith. By his faith, Abel still speaks instruction to us today, even though he is long dead." So you see, Abel was a herdsman, he looked after animals, and Cain looked, he planted things in the ground and harvested them. Sometimes we just want to offer to God what we think we do for God or what we think we have. But the Bible says by faith,
Abel received revelation. In the place, the heart of worship always doesn't just look at what they have in their storehouse of God, they look for what is it that God is looking for. Abel knew that God was looking for a blood sacrifice because he was foretelling the sacrifice that Jesus was going to make. You see, in worship, worship is prophetic. A life that is a heart of a worshiper connects with God in the prophetic things. They do things out of a place of heaven that becomes prophetic on earth. The life that seek after God and want to adore God, God saw something in their spirit. Their actions are prophetic. Their utterances are prophetic. They are not just seeing what people see on earth here. They see what God is revealing to them and they speak it out. Sometimes it's contrary to what the reality is on earth, but because they've caught it in God, they speak it out. Because, for example, what is happening now, we hear about this coronavirus and people losing their job. What are we doing? We are declaring what we are saying. But a worshiper will come from a place of revelation and bring on earth what God is declaring, what God wants to bless us with. You hear about this story about the U.S. election and all the shenanigans that's going on. And many of us get caught up in these things. Instead of waiting on God and hear, what is God speaking into the life of Donald Trump? What is God speaking into the life of Joe Biden? What is God speaking into the life of the Americans? What opportunities is God creating that he wants us to agree with him and start to declare? And the worshiper is a prayerful person because they tune into God and they use their life to declare what God is speaking to them, to speak, to bring to pass before it becomes a natural reality. Where are you hearing from? What are you connecting with? Many of us here, these prophets have become our sources. The news has become our source. The politicians have become our source. And we are dragged into all these things. And yet, God is there, wanting that. God has a plan. And God has something that he wants to do in our nation. But what are we doing? We are looking at what the Prime Minister is doing well, what he's not doing well. For you, you are the source, the hope of God to reach the nations, to bring heavenly dreams. Worshippers connect with God to bring to pass what God's will is. You see, the thing about the worshipper, because when you come before the throne of grace, you don't have to be a prophet to operate in the prophetic. You don't have to be somebody who has the anointing of healing to operate in the place of healing. Because once you know the heart of God, Jesus was saying, he said the thing in John chapter 4 and John chapter 5, the things I am five, he said, the things I see my Father do, they are the things I do. The things I hear my Father speak, the things I speak, I don't speak of myself, he said, because he was a worshiper. He spent time in the presence of the Father. He observed his Father. He saw what he was doing. Everything he saw there, he replicated on earth. He duplicated what he saw in heaven. Jesus was an open gate, the gate of heaven on earth. In the same way that you and I are heaven's gate on earth, Jesus was speaking to his disciples in John chapter 16. He said, the Holy Spirit will receive from me and will give to you. So in worship, what we do as we offer to God, Jesus comes and the Holy Spirit comes and receive from God and souls in our heart. And when we come here, we declare and we manifest and we demonstrate and we bring into reality what God is showing us. Hallelujah. The worshiper, the worshiping heart keeps his gaze on God. The worshiping heart keep his or her gaze on God. I remember going reading through my notes, was correcting, he said, you just use his. What about her? So I'm bringing her. It's his or her gaze. So men and women. Okay? In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 30, it says, even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So a worshipper is a waiter, a one who waits on the Lord. A worshipper waits on the Lord. A worshiper, somebody with the heart of worship, they wait on the Lord and the eyes is focused on the Lord to see what God is doing. And they respond. Every time God whispers, every time God raises his hand, they respond, Lord, what do you want? Because a worshiper is a giver. Okay? And then point number two, the worship is a life thing. Worship is 24/7. Bible tells us that the living beings, that they worship God all day and night without ceasing. They just keep saying, holy, 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 holy. For eternity, they are worshiping. And so worship is not just a Sunday thing. Worship is not just for Sunday morning. It is for eternity. It is not just our lifetime on earth here. It is what we'll be doing for the rest of our life, even in heaven. So when we're looking at worship, sometimes people will be saying, are we just going to be singing all day? But that's because you think worship is all singing. Worship is living. Worship is living. When you go to work and you do your job faithfully, to the best of your ability, to the glory of God, you are worshiping God. When you are selling that customer at the till, and you do it with a smile, and you love them, and you are reaching out to them, and you enjoy it, you are worshiping God. If you are a cleaner, when you go to your place of work and you clean those toilets and those bathrooms, and then when people mess up and some people don't even respect you, they look at you as an ordinary cleaner, then you are doing it with all your heart. As you are doing it, you are blessing the people. Anyone who will use this toilet today will come into God's grace and God's blessing and God's favor that God will meet them. What are you doing? You are worshiping God. If you work in a bank or BA, or you are a teacher, or you are a trainer, whatever you do, as you do it to the Lord, it's a life of worship. When you are doing, carrying out your responsibility as a mother to the glory of God, you are worshiping. When you are carrying out your responsibility as a husband, you are worshiping. So the worship is living. You live the life of worship. It's a 24/7 thing. A person with a heart of worship gives and God receives. Because most of the time we just say, Lord, please give me, Lord, give me, Lord, give me, Lord. But when it comes to a worshiper is always giving to God. And not just giving to God, they are giving to God what God wants. For many of us, we can give to God what we want to give to Him, but when God demands some things from us, we say no. Sometimes somebody has hurt you badly and God says forgive. He demands forgiveness. You say, no, I want to punish him. I want to make my point. I want to win. Worship is letting God win. Worship is giving to God what he demands. And in the verse that we read, we did finish it in verse 11, it says the 24 elders, they cast their crown on the floor, and they bowed down in worship, and they said, what? You are worthy, O Lord. To what? To receive. To receive. To receive. Not to give. To receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and for your pleasure they are and were created. Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive. In worship, God receives. Amen. He receives from our lives. He receives from our praise. He receives from our meditation. He receives when we give to people. He receives when we bless them. He receives when we do our job. Everything we do, when we are cooking and singing, and we are making sure people eat well, we are blessing people. God receives the blessings. So in worship, God receives. In worship, God receives. Bear that in mind. Make sure in your life, the question that you should be asking yourself, what is my life offering God today? In the things I'm doing now, is God, am I giving to God? When you see those difficult customers and you start to insult them, are you giving to God? Are you missing opportunities to offer this to God to say, Lord, for your name's sake, Lord? For the sake of your name, I'll let go. Hallelujah. My third point, and I want to spend some time to explain this. A worshiper has a broken spirit and a contrite heart. And God was saying, he said, a broken and a contrite heart he will not despise. And David prayed in Psalm 51. He cried out. He said, Can somebody put up Psalm 51 for me, please? Do I remember the verse? Now, hold on. I think I do.
17.
Verse 17, yes. Psalm 51. Let me put it up on my own so that I can read it here too. If you are there, can you read?
The sacrifices of God.
Oh, please come and use the microphone. Thank you very much.
The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. This, O God, you will not despise.
Hallelujah. My only sacrifice acceptable to God, thank you, Patricia. My only sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, broken with sorrow for sin, thoroughly patient. Such, O God, you will not despise. This is what David is saying after his sin. He said, my only sacrifice is a broken and contrite heart. And I just want to dwell on that. The word translated contrite is a Hebrew word, doha. It's pronounced doha. It means to be crushed or to be broken. And so look at the word that's used here. It said broken and contrite. In other words, broken and crushed. That's what it's saying. Broken and crushed. So in other words, double crushed. Or it could just mean to come to the place of God and just collapse in His presence. A worshipper is one with a broken and contrite heart. I want to give you an example of somebody with a broken spirit in the Bible. In Mark chapter 7, you don't need to turn to it, but if you want, you can. Mark chapter 7, verse 24 to 30, I'm not going to read it, but I'm just going to tell you the story. They can put it on the screen for you to follow. There was this Syrophoenician woman who is from a community in present day Syria and Palestine and part of Israel. She came to the Lord. She said, my daughter is being possessed with the spirit. And she wanted Jesus to deliver her. And Jesus speaking said to her, woman, we cannot take the food of the children of the house and give it to dogs. If that was you, even from hearing that from the mouth of Jesus, what would you say? I can't even believe that this holy man would say that. Are you even really the Christ? How can you make a statement like that? See, somebody that is contrite in spirit, he already knew. Jesus was saying, you call me a dog. Yes, I'm not really more than a dog without your grace. You know, outside of your grace, I'm a sinner that's worthy of death. I don't deserve healing. I don't even deserve to ask you to heal my son or my daughter. The woman she came with a broken spirit, a contrite heart. You know, the world would press against her. She would say, I know my weakness. A broken person knows their weakness. They don't esteem themselves better than they are. She recognized without grace of God, without the grace of God, she was nothing. And then she came in this humility, Lord, even the dogs, they eat crumbs that fall from the master's table. So she wasn't her. You know how many people lose their blessing because of her? They've served in the church, and then somebody does something to offend them, and they run away, they don't wait to receive God's blessing. You know how many people leave their marriage because of her? Because they've not been able to come to a place of brokenness. My husband did this, my wife did this, I cannot keep up with this. And so they leave. You know how many people leave their job? You know how many people even get out of their country? Some of them ask me to their family again. But this woman will not be cheated out of her blessing. She came with that broken spirit, a contrite heart. And she said, even the dogs. And what did Jesus say? Deborah, can you read it out? What was Jesus' response?
For such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter.
Jesus didn't even pray. He said, for such a reply, go. Your prayers answer. The demon has already left your daughter. You see, when you have a contrite, broken spirit, you don't need, you know, God in your actions bring deliverance. Your heart receive miracles before they happen. You also see the woman with the issue of blood in Mark 5:25-34. You see, she didn't even need to pray. She was there. She had that brokenness. When she reached out to Jesus, she wasn't trying to get somebody to get to Jesus to pray for her. She wasn't trying for Jesus to gain her attention. She just sneaked in. She must have really pushed her. She didn't touch the most precious part of Jesus. The Bible says she touched the hem, the lower part of the garment, not to be noticed. And what happened? Healing came without Jesus even praying. Instantly she was healed. That's what happened to people with brokenness. They know how to reach God in humility. You also see the centurion in Luke chapter 7, verse 1 to 10. The servant that he loved so much was dying. And he did not even think that he was worthy to approach Jesus. He sent people to Jesus to go and ask for favor to pray, to come to his house. And at a point, he sent a message again when Jesus was already coming. He said, please go and tell the master, I don't deserve you in my house. Just send the word. I'm a man of authority. When I say to this, do this and do this, you do. He said, send the word. And Jesus said, I've never found any faith like this, not even in Israel. People with broken spirit operate in high faith. And instantly, his servant was healed. Brokenness is the heart of worship. You can be gifted in every other area when you learn to recognize your weakness. That it's only God's grace that's carrying you. When you come before God, there is nothing you cannot offer, but whatever He says, you accept. Even if you struggle with it, you say, Lord, I know you are right. I pray for the spirit of brokenness in you. A contrite heart. Because what God does with brokenness, Deborah, you can come up here so that you guys can come and sing the verse. When the place of worship is a place where you are crushed. God comes and the issues of life come and press against you to crush you. You know why? Because who has to squeeze those sweetness of God out of you? The goodness of God that is in you, God wants to press it out. So that crushing, that pressing, it causes the Jews to come out that everywhere you go, people taste of God's goodness. The taste of God's sweetness. But it takes you humbling yourself. It takes you wearing that, what we call like that straight jacket. But it allows God to squeeze His goodness, the sweetness of His goodness, the sweetness of heaven. But when a person that comes to carry God's brokenness, they lose heaven. God's goodness drips out of their life. Wherever they go, they drink. They drink God's goodness and they touch many lives. May the Lord bring you to a place of brokenness in Jesus' name. Father, I just pray for everyone today who's at the sound of my voice, that you will bring them to a place of brokenness when your sweetness and your goodness will flow through. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. May the Lord bless you as we sing this last song. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Be gracious to you, the Lord. Please.